Mark Twain's recent biographer, Ron Powers, has said that Mark Twain was a prodigious noticer. And in fact, Twain, as well as anyone I know, lived up to the advice of his literary nemesis, Henry James, who said, "Try to be one of the people upon whom nothing is lost." And the first thing I want to say is that Mark Twain was such a person. Both as writer and speaker, he learned from every source and every experience. I want to give you a little overview of what I'll be talking about today. First off, I want to just give an overview of Twain's speaking career. Secondly, I want to give a little bit of historical context on the art and business of public speaking in 19th century America. Third, look at some of the influences that shaped Mark Twain as the distinctive, unique public speaker he was. Fourth, if you can keep track of all these, talk about Twain's aims and methods or practices of public speaking, how he trained himself. And then I want to finish by showing a couple segments from the foremost impersonator of Mark Twain of the 20th and early 21st century, Mr. Hal Holbrook, in his production Mark Twain Tonight, in which he impersonates Twain as a 70-year-old man giving a talk on stage in 1905. So a lot of what I'll be talking about will be illustrated in that video. First to the history. Twain gave his first public speech in 1853 in Keokuk, Iowa, sort of near his home turf, to a banquet of printers, members of his journalist trade. But the first speech that really launched his career occurred in October 1866 in the city of San Francisco. Twain had recently returned from a journey to the Sandwich Islands, where he worked as a reporter for the Sacramento Union. And when he got back into the lower 48 and was looking, as he always was, for a way to pick up a little bit of extra cash, he decided, why not take the story of his adventures and experiences at the Sandwich Islands onto the public platform? Well, this he did. And years later, when he looked back on that speech, he always described it as a traumatic experience. He didn't eat for 3 days. Before he got on the stage. He worried that no one was going to show up. He looked over his manuscript of his speech, and he said that every time he looked at it, it looked less and less funny. He finally showed up in the auditorium, the music hall in San Francisco, and describes how he paced nervously back and forth for an hour before finally thrusting himself onto the stage in front of the footnotes, and then looked out speechless at the crowd, which was, there were a lot of people, between 1,500 and 2,000. He couldn't untie his tongue for a full minute. And then, as he relates, I began to talk. And the rest is history. It was reported as a side-splittingly hilarious evening. All of the reporters, the newspapers loved it. And Twain immediately decided to take his show on the road, went to other places in Northern California and down into Western Nevada. And he quickly discovered, as did most everyone who heard him, that he had a natural ability to be on the stage. Other tours followed throughout the 1870s as Twain was becoming more famous through his published books. In 1884 and 1885, he embarked on one of his most important tours with a guy by the name of George Washington Cable, who was a fellow writer. And this tour was touted as the Twins of Genius tour. And though Twain wasn't exactly excited about the twins aspect, preferring then as always to have the limelight to himself, that tour is important to us in this room because it was during that tour that Twain first read to the general public passages from The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn on the eve of its publication in 1885. So that was an important speech for him. In 1895, when he was just past the age of 60, Twain undertook the most strenuous tour of his career. In fact, a world tour that took him to 5 continents in some 150 engagements. He loved most every minute, even though the reason for this strenuous tour was not a very happy one. He was trying to pay off enormous debts that he had built up through some really stupid investments in business and his own lavish lifestyle. And I might add here that Twain often, throughout his career, from the 1870s on, complained continually about crummy travel tradition, conditions, bad train rides, tiresome boat rides, shabby hotels, occasional bad company in the towns where he visited. And he swore again and again that he was going to quit the stage once and for all. But he always came back, and that was for the simple reason he loved it. He loved being in the limelight. He was only happy when he was talking or in motion. And again, he had a natural gift for it. Now, in his last years, as tragedy struck in his family, Twain quit touring, and he eventually, remarkably for him, I think, even stopped lecturing for pay. But that was because he wanted to get on a stage and say exactly what he felt like saying. And that jibed well with his increasing sense of moral outrage at inhumanity and the problems of the world. Thereafter, Twain continued to speak at banquets, which often lasted till 2 or 3 in the morning. No problem for him, he just slept till 2 or 3 in the afternoon the next day. He would speak at meetings, public gatherings in support of causes he believed in, notably women's rights and pacifism. And in general, if there was any kind of public gathering of three people or greater where Mark Twain was present, a speech from him was expected, it was happily delivered, and it was generally the dramatic highlight of the evening. So that's Twain's career in a nutshell. But he wasn't speaking in a vacuum. What was the tradition of speaking in America at that time? Well, long before radio and television and the rest, the a primary form of public entertainment and education was the public lecture. 1826 is an important date because in that year, a man named Josiah Holbrook created the first lyceum in the town of Millbury, Massachusetts. Now, the Lyceum, which took its name from Aristotle's ancient academy in Athens, was simply a course of public lectures intended for the education and edification of the community. Holbrook's idea took hold, and in a few years, all of the major cities in the East and then spreading out west developed their own lyceum programs, as did many average and smaller-sized towns. And so each of these towns and cities would host a course of lectures, generally going from October to March of each year. The topics of these lectures ran the whole gamut of human knowledge. And I thought I'd just read you a few characteristic titles. The Coming Girl, Modern Society, Muscle and Good Cheer, no. Hours with the British Poets, sounds like a very pleasant one, Nature and Art, and my favorite, Whither Are We Drifting? Speakers range from the famous to the lesser known, from the national to the local, and I'll just give you a few names of the celebrated figures who spoke. Ralph Waldo Emerson, who was really just winding up at the time Twain took off. Frederick Douglass, the ex-slave, abolitionist, and leading African-American intellectual of his generation. Wendell Phillips, a leading agitator and reformer. Henry Ward Beecher, who was the most famous and later scandalous preacher in America. Waterhouse Hawkins, the famed paleontologist. Horace Greeley, the editorial journalist. Many others, Julia Ward Howe, Elizabeth Cady Stanton, a leading women's rights advocate of the time. For our purposes, the most important thing to notice about these speakers is that the tone of their speeches was generally serious, and the speaker was generally expected to announce a topic and then stick to that topic for the 1 or 2 hours of time that they were on stage. Now, in his own public speaking, Mark Twain was neither serious nor focused. In fact, one of his major innovations was to be funny and to build his lectures around humorous stories, anecdotes, and asides. His performances, in short, were nothing like lectures as we think of the term today. Now, I should add that Twain was not the only person to innovate with humor and with storytelling. There were many others, but he is the one who, beyond doubt, became the most celebrated this mode. I'm not going to say much about Twain's style here because I'm going to leave that to Mr. Holbrook on the video, but a few characteristics. Nonchalance. A kind of easy wandering around the stage. He wasn't one of these who was stuck to the podium. A thoroughly, thoroughly conversational manner. He was not a podium thumper or a finger jabber, or there were many, you know, kind of acrobatic speakers who would pace the stage and stamp their feet and all of the flourishes. And Twain, very radical in his departure from that. Hamlin Garland said of Twain that he created an easy, home-like style that put everyone at ease. So a man or woman sitting in a packed auditorium of 2,000 people could have the illusion that Mark Twain was speaking intimately and directly to him or her. He had that enormous gift for that. An 1885 newspaper review gives a more detailed picture of Twain on stage, and I quote, "He came in with his head forward and looked like a man who had lost something on the stage and wasn't exactly sure what he would be able to find. He faced the audience with a puzzled, careworn expression as if he had met the people before but couldn't just at the moment recall their names. His half-closed eyes appeared to peer out from under the bushy brows with a puzzled gaze that had been regarding life seriously for 40-odd years and couldn't quite make it out. He told his stories with that inimitable down-east drawl of his and took his audience into his confidence with a serious unconventionality that was most delightful. He also reminds you of someone you have seen before. You can't tell who, but you're friends with him for old acquaintance sake from the first." But where did this style of Mark Twain's come from? What were its sources? Well, Mark Twain's style was never to lecture in the sense of explicating a topic. It was always to tell stories. Storytelling was his natural mode of expression. As a young boy growing up in Missouri, he liked to listen to Uncle Daniel, a slave on his uncle's farm, and hear him tell stories. And Twain's first experience, I think this is really important for Huckleberry Finn, his first experience of literature, and an abiding sense of literature, was that it is primarily an oral art of storytelling. He's like many other writers who have a kind of love-hate relationship with the printed word. They loved it because it disseminated the books to so many, but always preferred the intimate contact of speech. Twain absorbed this art as a boy, and then further as a man when he moved out west during the Civil War, where he came in contact with some really famous tall tale storytellers, that's a tongue twister of the day. Josh Billings and Petroleum Nasby were two of them, and many others, professionals and amateurs, you know, hanging around in taverns and in the mines and in the towns out in Virginia and elsewhere. In 1863, an important experience, he heard Artemus Ward speak. Artemus Ward was probably the most famous humorist of his day. And it is told that when Twain was listening to Ward speak, while everyone else around him was splitting up with laughter, Mark Twain was absolutely serious, doubtless absorbing what he could from Artemus Ward's manner, seeing what he could learn from Artemus Ward. Well, what were Artemus Ward's trademark skills as a speaker? One thing was, well, he told a lot of stories that didn't seem to connect with each other. He exaggerated, made use of the art of exaggeration, the use of anticlimax, where he'd work up to a story and then sort of like let it drop, and the crowd just loved it. They broke up, cracked up. One of his leading in his best skills, which Twain really glommed onto, was that Artemus Ward would look at his audience with an absolutely serious face while he was telling the most outrageously funny story. So it was like everyone else got the joke but himself. And that was extremely effective. So Twain adapted these techniques of Artemus Ward and the other storytellers. And what he did was to take those and, over the next 40 years, hone them to absolute perfection. But I have not yet mentioned the most important thing that he learned from Artemus Ward and others, and that is that the how of the storytelling is always more important than the what. Twain believed that you could take a really mediocre story, and if you told it with the right pauses and inflection, facial expression, if your timing was right, you could make it really, really funny. On the other hand, you could take a text that was perfection itself on the page and ruin it. And this is literally what Twain said. You could ruin it by being a split second off in the punchline, you know, if your pausing was off by a second. So this doesn't necessarily fit our image of Mark Twain, but he was a guy who actually stood there when he was preparing his speeches and timed, like, to the second, how long he would pause before delivering the most important line of his speech. Twain later, when he was famous and his speeches were quoted in the newspaper, he lamented the fact that those words that were so alive in an auditorium became dead and corpse-like when they were turned into print in the newspaper. This is a little quotation from Twain. "You do not recognize the corpse. You wonder if this is really that gay and handsome creature of the evening before. You wonder if this is really... You look him over and find that he certainly is those very remains. Then you want to bury him. You wish you could bury him privately." Another question, how did Twain get so good at what he did? Well, the first and the obvious answer is natural genius. We'll get that one out of the way right away. But he also worked really hard. He studied other speakers and learned everything he could from them, both from good examples and bad examples. And I want to give you just one example. One of the highest paid speakers in the middle of the 19th century was a woman named Anna Dickinson. Ring any bells? No, not Emily, not that Dickinson, but Anna Dickinson. We don't remember her today, but at the time, people like Twain and others were insanely jealous of her because she was paid so well. Well, Anna Dickinson tended to give speeches on hot-button political issues. Twain heard her talk in New York on the topic of women's rights. And Anna Dickinson had a fierce, fiery, earnest, real 19th century muscular type of style of speaking. She did a lot of this. Hope I don't mess up your camera here, but she would pace back and forth on the platform like this in front of her audience, and then suddenly come forward and spit out some, you know, really impassioned point to them. Twain absorbed it, and he'd watch these speakers and then record his reactions in his notebooks. Twain recorded in his notebook his admiration for the fact that this woman, Anna Dickinson, could command an audience so well. This is what he wrote. Her vim, her energy, her determined look would compel the respect and attention of an audience, even if she spoke in Chinese. On the other hand, he criticized her for poor timing. He felt that she had the audience there, and then she lost them when she would work laboriously towards a conclusion. So this is a good example of Twain learning from a speaker who's, I mean, as I've tried to dramatize her, I think you get the point. She's not exactly Mark Twain's style. It's almost his complete opposite. And yet, he still felt that he could learn things from her. He learned a lot from preachers. Twain was always interested in preachers, and especially how they spoke, for instance, how they did the Lord's Prayer. He felt that you could ruin that prayer by pausing at the wrong time. He also thought, as a curious aside, at one time of becoming a preacher himself. As he put it, quote, "It never occurred to me that a preacher could be damned. Looked like a safe job," end quote. Sometimes Twain even spoke of his own platform speaking as preaching in a kind of half-humorous way. In 1868 in New York, Twain heard Charles Dickens come through as he was doing a tour. And once again, ever the observer, Twain was immediately in awe and ever so admiring of Charles Dickinson's animation, liveliness, and stage presence. You know, anyone could write things like the Pickwick Papers. You had to be very vital on the stage. Twain was taken with this. On the other hand, he could not, for the life of himself, understand what Dickens was saying, you know, because of the English accent. So we can infer that he probably made a little mental note and then put it into his notebook to work on his own articulation and enunciation. And that's what he did. And Hamlin Garland later described Twain as, quote, an excellent elocutionist, end quote. Next point, Twain's aims and methods concerning public speaking. First, the aim, that's simple. To make people laugh, to get hold of their interest instantly, and not let it go for a minute until he was finished. Everything else that Twain did was directed towards that aim. As for his practices, a couple were especially important. One, constant practice. Wherever Twain was, he tended to be the center of attention. In fact, I don't know if this is true, but from what I understand, there's only one person in the world who ever out-talked Mark Twain, and that was Kaiser Wilhelm of Germany, who was a complete bore. But Twain had to sit next to him once at some banquet, and Mark Twain could not get a word in edgewise. Otherwise, though, any place he was, anywhere he was hanging out, he took over. He walked into a room, he was it. So he was constantly observing how people reacted to his stories. He was constantly practicing his pausing again, his inflection, his, you know, all of the speakerly arts. You can actually imagine Mark Twain. In my imagination, I see him when he's alone walking around and muttering to himself and practicing his speeches and practicing his timing all the time. A second important practice was tireless revision to achieve a final effect of complete spontaneity. I've got a note scrawled here. I hope I can make it out. It's in my text in pencil and in longhand. If anyone here is a student who's seen my longhand knows this is not going to be easy. But here, a reporter, I'm quoting from what a reporter once said about Mark Twain's spontaneity. The jokes were uttered as if he had just thought of them a minute before and didn't perceive the point of them quite as well as the audience. Okay? Sounds like Artemus Ward. Yet we know, and this is what Mark Twain said, that it would take him 4 days to work up an impromptu speech. 4 days to where I hope you got the irony in that. So there we have the tireless revision. Here's another quotation from Twain about this process. I write my lectures and try to memorize them, but I don't always succeed. If I had a better memory, it would be worse in some respects. For when one has to fill up an ellipsis on the spot, there is a spontaneity about the thing which is a considerable relief. So actually, and when we see Hal Holbrook on here, that text that he is giving is not just sort of winging it. He's actually memorized every single word, and that's what Twain did. And that, what that did was it enabled him, when he was on stage, not to have to be, you know, looking at notes or be scratching his head and thinking, oh golly, what was the next story I was going to do? He could be focusing on the higher level issues of, is that person out there asleep? Or why is that one slumped over? Or how am I, was my pausing and timing right in this story? And things like that. Here's my favorite. This, I think, sums up Mark Twain's practice as a public speaker better than anything else. And I love this one so much. I've memorized this. And I encourage anyone who writes or speaks or does any kind of art, whether it's verbal or other, to you know, cut this in stone or something or hang it above your desk. Here it is. Drill is the valuable thing. drill, drill, drill in italics. That is the precious thing. For from drill comes the automatic, and few things in this world are well done until they can do themselves. Magnificent quote. So that's what it's all about, is achieving, you know, through that constant practice. And what I like about that is, again, if I were to ask you what's one of the last words you would associate with Mark Twain, it's probably the word drill. But this is the man. Yeah, sure. Yeah, I'd love to. Drill is the valuable thing, period. Drill, dash. Drill, dash. And then the third drill, italicized. That is the precious thing, period. For from drill comes the automatic, comma, and few things in this world are well done until they can do themselves. The last two words are in italics, do themselves. Finally, one final point on Twain's speaking style, and that is has to do with how he did his books on stage. As we'll see Hal Holbrook doing Mark Huckleberry Finn here. When he heard Charles Dickens talk in New York, Dickens brought one of his books out and read from it. And when Twain went on the 1884-85 tour promoting Huckleberry Finn, the first thing he tried was taking the book out on the stage and actually reading from it. The results, according to him, were, quote, ghastly. There was something too literary about it. And so within a week, he had left the book behind offstage, and he'd started this practice of memorizing the stories, word for word. So when you hear Huck Finn, that's memorized. And then when you go out on the stage, he wouldn't exactly repeat it verbatim, but he'd have the gist of it, and he could kind of improvise where he forgot a phrase. And that way he could make the language more flexible and more appropriate to the context of a public audience instead of the literary one. Last question, was Twain only a humorist? And this gets to the point Catherine was raising earlier. Though his main aim was always to seduce people and make them laugh, as this clip on here will show, there was often, particularly in his later years, serious content sandwiched between the gales of laughter. Such commentary, like the darkly serious underpinnings we have been looking at all year long in The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn, lift Twain out of the category of mere entertainer and into the category of public intellectual, especially in his last two decades, when he was said to have the most recognizable face on the planet. Twain's opinions on any and all subjects held weight and drew global attention. Outraged, as he often was, by the inhumanity of humanity, by racism, colonialism, imperialism, war, religious hypocrisy, and injustices of all kinds, Twain could not forbear to attack these topics frontally. One wonders whether these unabashedly blunt musings on human nature might not acquire special potency because they are being told by a funny man who told funny stories. They take us by surprise. Here as elsewhere, we see that Mark Twain's sense of timing and audience was impeccable, and that underneath his outwardly unsophisticated persona, he was a remarkably incisive and, yes, serious writer. With that, I want to...
I want to bring you a selection from Huckleberry Finn. Now, this is a book about a boy. Some of you have been boys. And the rest of you have had a good deal to do with boys. Now, Huckleberry Finn is a story of a boy who lived a great many years ago in the Mississippi River Valley. He was ignorant, unwashed, insufficiently fed. but he had as good a heart as ever any boy had. And he was the only really independent person, boy or man, in the community. And for this reason, I suppose, he was continually happy. Now, in this book, Huckleberry tells his own story, all by himself. You don't know about me without you've read a book by the name of The Adventures of Tom Sawyer. That book was made by Mr. Mark Twain, and he told the truth, mainly. Well, there's some things he stressed, but mainly he told the truth. Why, that ain't nothing. Well, I never seen anybody but lie at one time or another without it was Aunt Polly or the widow Douglas. The widow, she took me for her son and allowed she would civilize me. She cried over me and called me a poor lost lamb. She called me a lot of other names, too. But she never meant no harm by it. Well, then she dressed me up in some of them new clothes, and I couldn't do nothing but sweat and feel all cramped up. Pretty soon I wanted to smoke, but the waiter, she wouldn't let me. She said it was a mean practice and weren't clean, and I should try not to do it anymore. Ain't that just the way with some people, though? They get down on a thing when they don't know nothing about it. She took snuff, too. Of course, that was all right, because she done it herself. Then her sister, Miss Watson, a tolerable slim old maid with goggles on, she's all the time saying, "Don't put your feet up there, Huckleberry. Don't scrunch up like that, Huckleberry. Sit up straight. Can't you try to behave?" Then she told me all about the bad place, and I said, "I wish I was there." She got mad then. But I never meant no harm. All I wanted was a change. All I wanted was to go somewhere that I wanted particularly. She said she was going to live so as to go to the good place. Well, I couldn't see no advantage in going where she was going. So I made up my mind I wouldn't try for it. Well, I've been going to school along about 4 or 5 months. And I learned to read and write. And say the multiplication table up to 6 times 7 is 35. I don't reckon I could ever get any further than that if I lived forever. And then one night I lit my candle and went up to my room, and there sat Pap, his own self. He tore into me something awful for dressing up and putting on airs and going to school. And then he catched me and tucked me up the river to a little log cabin over on the Illinois shore. I never got no chance to run off. Pap, he was so handy with his hickory, I couldn't hardly stand it. I was all over welts. Once that he'd been drunk over in town, he come back and says how folks were saying there was going to be another trial to get me away from him and give it to the widow for my guardian. And then he got to cussing and says he likes to see that widow get me. Whenever his liquor began to work, he most always went for the government. This time he says, "Call this a government? Why, just look at it and see what it's like. Why, here's the law standing ready to take a man's son away from him. Man's own son. Which he's had all the trouble and all the anxiety and all the expense of reason. Just as that man's got that son all raised up, ready to go to work, do something for him. Give him a rest. Why, the law up and goes to him. They call that government. Why, a man can't get his rights in a government like this. Why, looky here, there's a free nigger over there from Ohio. Mulatto. Most watch a white man. He had on the whitest shirt you ever see, and the shiniest hat. He had a gold watch and a chain. What do you think? Well, they said he was a professor in a college and could talk all kind of languages and knowed everything. That ain't the worst. They said he could vote when he was at home. Well, that let me out. Thinks I watched this country a coming to. Why, it was election day and I was just about to go and vote myself. I wasn't too drunk to get there. When they told me there was a state in this country where they'd let that nigger vote, I drawed out. I says I'll never vote again as long as I live them to bear words, I said. You all heard me. And the country may rot for all of me. I'll never vote again as long as I live. Old Pap, he was carrying on, so he never noticed where his old limber legs was taking him. He went head over heels over a tub of salt pork and barked both shins. Rest his speech is all the hardest kind of language. Then he let out all of a sudden with his left foot and fetched that tub a rattling kick. But it weren't good judgment. That's a boot that had a couple of his toes leaking out of the front end of it. Well, I run off from Pat pretty soon after that. And I hid out on Jackson's Island. That's where I met Miss Watson's Jim. He says he run off too. Well, I promised I wouldn't tell on him. I know that I done wrong. When old folks would despise me and call me a low-down abolitionist, but I didn't care. I wasn't going back there again anyway. Jim and me, we found an empty section of log raft. We went off down that river together. We run nights and laid up and hid daytimes. We just let that raft float wherever the current wanted it to. It's lovely to live on raft. We'd lay in our backs and smoke our pipes, looking away into the sky. Not a cloud in it. Sky looks ever so deep when you lay on your back in the moonshine. I never knowed it before. And how fur a body can hear on the water such nights. I'd go to sleep. Sometimes Jim wouldn't wake me when it was my turn to stand watch. He often done that. Then when I woke up long about daybreak, he'd be sitting there with his head down betwixt his knees, moaning and mourning. One of them took no notice nor let on, but I knowed what he was for. He was thinking about his wife and children way up yonder. And he was feeling low and homesick. Because, you see, he had never been away from home before in his life. Well, I do reckon he cared just as much for his people as white folks does for theirs. Don't seem natural, but I reckon it's so. We kept looking for Cairo down at the foot of Illinois, where the Ohio River comes in. We said we'd sell the raft and get on a steamboat and go way up the Ohio amongst the free states and then be out of trouble. Jim, he says it made him all over trembly and feverish to be so close to freedom. He says how the first thing he'd do when he got to a free state, he would go to work saving up money and never spend a single cent. And when he got enough, he would buy his, he would buy his wife, which is owned on a farm near Miss Watson. And they'd both go to work and buy the two children. and if their master wouldn't sell them, he'd get an abolitionist to go and steal them. Well, it most froze me to hear such talk. Well, Jimmy would never dare talk such talk in his life before, coming right out flat-footed and saying he would steal his children. Children which was owned by a man I didn't even know. Man who had never done me no harm. You see, I begun to get it through my head that he was most free. And who was to blame for it? Me. It had never come down to me before what this thing was that I was doing. My conscience got a stirring me up hotter and hotter, and finally our sets would all let up on me, will you? I'll paddle ashore at the first light and tell. Pretty soon one showed. Jim, he got all excited because he thought it was Caro. But I said, no, let me paddle ashore in the canoe and see, Jim. It might not be, you know. Well, then he got the canoe ready for me and give me the paddle and I shove out. And when I was about 50 yards off, he calls out, "There you go. The old true Huck. The only white gentleman that ever kept his promise to old Jim." I just felt sick. Yeah, I was paddling off all in a sweat to tell on him, but when he says that, it just kind of seemed to take the tuck right out of me. And I weren't right down certain whether I was glad I started, whether I weren't. I says to myself, I got to do it. I can't get out of it. Right then along comes a skiff with two men in it, with guns. And they stop, and I stop, and one of them says, "What's that yonder?" "A piece of raft." "You belong on it?" "Yes, sir." "Any men on it?"
"Only one, sir."
"Well, there's five niggers run off tonight up yonder around the head of the bend. Is your man white or black?"
"He's white." They went off. Well, I knowed I'd done wrong. Well, I guess it weren't no use me learning to do right. Well, if I'd have gone to Sunday school and learned how to behave, I'd have known what to do, but... Well, you see, a body that don't get started right when he's little just ain't got no show. I says to myself, hold on. If you'd have done right and give Jim up, would you feel better than you do now? Well, no, I says, I'd feel bad. I'd feel the same way I do right now. Well, then, says I, what's the use in you learning to do right when it's troublesome to do right and ain't no trouble to do wrong? And the wages are just the same. Well, I was stuck. I couldn't answer that. So I just shoved the whole thing right out of my head. And I said I would take up wickedness again, which was in my line, being brung up to it. And for a starter, I would go to work and steal Jim out of slavery. And if that meant I was going to hell, then I would just go to hell.
Thank you.
Well, it's a comical invention, the human race, any way you look at it. But sometimes it does seem a shame that Noah and his party did not miss the boat. You probably noticed that the human race is a curiosity. Originally, man started out a little lower than the angels, and he's been getting a little lower ever since. To place him properly at the present time, he stands somewhere between the angels and the French. Oh, man is a marvel, he is. He's invented himself a heaven and emptied into it all the nations of the earth, all in one common jumble, and all of them on an equality absolute. They have to be brothers. They have to mix together and pray together and harp and hosanna together. Whites, Negroes, Jews, everybody. There's no distinctions. And yet down here on earth, all the nations hate each other and fight each other, and every one of them persecutes the Jew. And yet every pious person adores that heaven and wants to get into it. He really does now, isn't that marvelous? And when he's in a holy rapture, he thinks that if he could only get up there, he would take that whole populace to his heart and hug and hug and hug. I wonder if God invented man because he was disappointed in the monkey. Training and association can accomplish strange miracles sometimes. In my schoolboy days, I had no aversion to slavery. I was not aware that there was anything wrong about it. Local papers said nothing against it. Local pulpit taught us that God approved of it, that it was a holy thing, and the doubter need only look in the Bible if he wished to settle his mind. And then the texts were read aloud to us to make the matter sure. If there were passages in the Bible which disapproved of slavery, they were not quoted by our pastors. I wonder how they could lie so. Result of practice, no doubt. And the serene confidence of a Christian with four aces. When I was a boy, I saw a brave gentleman deride and insult a lynching mob and drive it away. For the truth is that no mob has any sand in it. In the presence of a man known to be splendidly brave, but where should such brave men be found? If physically brave men would do, why, that'd be easy. They could be had by the cargo. But morally brave men and women who can face up to church-going gangs of hooded murderers. Don't seem to be very many morally brave people left in stock. We appear to be in a condition of profound poverty there. What we really need is some starters, but where should we get them? Advertise? Very well, then, let's advertise.
Meanwhile, there's another plan. Why don't we import American missionaries from China and send them into the lynching field? Well, there are 1,511 American missionaries out there converting 2 Chinamen apiece per annum against an uphill birth rate of 33,000 pagans per day. Now, if we can offer our missionaries as rich a field at home, at lighter expense, and quite satisfactory in the matter of danger, why shouldn't they come back and give us a trial? Why, those Chinese people are universally conceded, to be honest. Industrious, honorable. Why don't we give those poor things a rest, huh? Besides, every convert runs the risk of catching our civilization. Want to think twice before we encourage a risk like that. For once, civilized China can never be uncivilized again. I've been thinking about that. Oh, kind missionary. Oh, compassionate missionary, leave China. Come home and convert these Christians. Oh, what a hell of a heaven it's going to be when all those hypocrites assemble there.
I was going to love time for discussion, especially at the video or anything else. If there are questions, I might be able to answer. Are there any comments that anyone would like to make? Or comments on the video? Yes.
Well, I just have a kind of a silly question. I personally didn't know that he did speeches. Are his speeches available
to read? Yeah.
Are they really?
Yeah, in fact, you can get the speeches. They're right here at Weber's Library. I mean, you can get a hard copy. You can probably get them online, too. I have the book checked out right now. But I'll bring it back for you.
Wow.
Yeah. And by the way, all that stuff that Holbrook did is, it's from Twain.
I've seen Holbrook in performance.
Oh, boy.
He was at the U at Kingsbury Hall about 2 or 3 years ago in the spring. And I'd known about him and had used some of his recordings when I was teaching high school. But if you have a chance to see him in person, it's amazing. He's so talented, and he captures the audience in such a way that you just can't believe how good he is. It's wonderful.
And he's been doing it long.
Twain did.
Yeah, he's been doing it since
54.
Yeah.
1950. Yeah. Well, let me qualify that. It's word for word, but like Twain, there's, you know, improv in there, because it's
pieces better, aren't they?
Exactly, and what Holbrook did, and there's also a book you can get from Weber's Library, Hal Holbrook's book called Mark Twain Tonight, where he talks really fascinating about the history of this production and how he assembled the speeches and how he researched the character and style of Mark Twain. But with the Huckleberry Finn, you can see how, as Twain himself did, he stitched together pieces here and there so that it's almost an abridged version of the first half of the novel. All the key thing, passages and characters in there. Yeah. Yes, Molly?
John, is that the scientific format that he reads from his book? And it seems to be go extra bold.
Mm-hmm.
Talking about various other topics.
Yeah, and if you see this entire video, it's exactly an hour and a half, which was the standard length of Twain's lectures. And Holbrook was very particular about planting the Huck Finn episode right smack in the middle. And Mark Twain as well liked to kind of alternate for sake of, you know, keeping audience interest and providing variety and also surprising them. So he's got, you know, he'd have a part, read from a book, or read, you know, perform from a book, and then he would step over, as we saw. And one reason I wanted to do those two segments, because you could see how he transitioned from that into his very blunt remarks about humanity, and that was his mode. So there's always something, the audience is always engrossed, but also just enough off balance that you can't fall asleep. You know, there's no way, because what's he going to pull out of his sleeve next? So it's an interesting contrast, I think, between his casual style and his keep you on the edge of your seat. And what I think is amazing is his courage of pausing. I mean, it's really hard to pause when you're talking. You always feel like you got to go, And Twain got rid of that mannerism very early on, but you could see how even in here he could stand still for, you could count them, probably 15 seconds with absolute silence. And then on occasion he would be in telling a story and he actually would forget where he was going, and he'd pick up, he'd just have a long pause and then pick up with another story, and the audience didn't notice. He used that pause as a flexible tool. Yes?
I have a question. Just in that little bit we watched, he has some pretty overt criticism of Christianity. How was that received at the time? I mean, was some of that lost on the audience, or did they just laugh it off?
I like what a guy named Julian Barnes said about irony, and Twain is among, I think, the world's great ironists. He said, irony is what people miss, which is a good... one of Twain's counterparts, Jonathan Swift, Gulliver's Travels. Many people can read that book straight through and not realize that the book is about them. And in the same way, Twain can be taken on many levels, and so you can, a group of people can watch that same commentary and take from it completely different things. So one person will catch the irony, perhaps be offended properly by it or insulted in a way that they might take a second look at themselves. Another person just go right by. So that's part of Twain's power, and also I guess one of the potential disadvantages of his style is that you don't know when he's being, or a lot of people have a hard time telling when he's being serious and when he's not. So people generally saw Twain as just a marvelously entertaining evening, and I think they could, when he was jabbing them with the barbs of his satire, if it was convenient, they could just not feel anything. I don't know if that answers your question. But, yeah.
What was the title of this video?
It's called Mark Twain Tonight. I recommend getting it. It's really good. I would love to have played the whole thing, because it's very hard to select the passages that I did. Well, thank you so much for coming. It's been a lot of fun. Thank you.